Thank you very much. You know, you can get an introduction like that if you're really old and spend a lot of time doing a lot of different things. My wife says it's because I can't hold a position, so I have to keep moving on to something else. But I want to start first by saying I do go back a long ways. Back in the early days of the movement, Ron Robinson had hair. And it was tough in those days. My old friend Stan Evans, who died recently, said that when you're talking to young people, you should really talk to them about how tough we had it. He said, you know, back in those days, they didn't have remotes for television, so we actually had to get up out of our chairs and go change the channel ourselves without doing it by remote. It was tough for other reasons, but I'd like to thank Ron Robinson for what he does. And the Journalism Center is really a great operation. We at the Washington Times take folks from the interns from the Journalism Center. We're proud to have them. They do a great job. And I hope we give them some kind of some training that they can use as they move on. You know, we like to talk, or maybe we don't like to, but we have to talk about the media and how the media is, in fact, biased. It's always been that way. But when you look back at the work that the Journalism Center here does, the work that Young America's Foundation does, and the work that the other groups do, you go back to the beginnings of our movement. The modern conservative movement really is a post-World War II phenomena, and it began as a movement of ideas, not politics, but ideas. It began on college campuses, and the fact that you're here today bodes well for our future, because it was on our college campuses that this movement began. Remember, Bill Buckley in 1955 started National Review. He had published a book, God and Man at Yale, when he was your age, shortly after he'd graduated from the university. And that really began to bring together people dedicated to ideas of freedom and tradition who put together a movement that later morphed into an incredible political movement. And looking back on it, one of the reasons that what Young America's Foundation does is so important is that there wasn't much in those days. It was assumed and reported continually by the intellectual elite of the day that there was no reasonable expectation of an American conservative movement, that conservatism in America was at best a pathology that would disappear with education and enlightenment. Conservatives on college campuses then, as now, were sometimes ignored, more often demonized, isolated, and made to feel that there must not be anyone that thought the way that they did. And I'm sure that some of you are here, and one of the reasons you value these things is because some of you no doubt feel isolated on your college campus. Let me tell you, back then, and one of the advantages of being old is that you get to tell stories about the past. But I remember forming the Young Americans for Freedom chapter at the University of Wisconsin. I don't know how many students there are there now, but in those days there were 40,000 of them. And in those days you needed a faculty advisor. Unfortunately, after contacting 100 or so professors and associate professors, no one was willing to associate themselves with conservative ideas on that entire large campus. Finally, we got somebody from the who was a professor but was working in the administration, who said that he would serve as our campus advisor so long as we allowed him to attach with his name the statement that he didn't agree with anything that we had to say. But at least in those days, liberals believed that if they didn't agree with things that you had to say, you nevertheless, foolish as you might be, had a right to say them. That, of course, has changed in the ensuing years, so that today, around this country, most liberals, or progressives as they like to call themselves these days, don't really think that you and I have a right to say the things that we believe if they disagree with the common wisdom of progressive thought. But in those days, you were really up against it, just as you are now. And this has gone on, really, in American politics, probably for longer than that. The formation of National Review in 1955 was, as I say, the starting point. But when I talk to young people and students particularly, I suggest that one of the books that you might want to read, in addition to the classics of conservatism, is a book written by a non-conservative, Daniel Yergin of Harvard University, who in 1989 wrote a book called The Commanding Heights, The Battle for the Market in America. Yergin had not been a conservative, but he spent his time studying what had gone on in the post-World War II world. And he said that first he found that the 1950s were the height of collectivism, not just in the United States, but the world over. The 1950s were the era of the five-year plan, where the government was believed in every country to be able to do just about everything that it wanted, that it could take care of its citizens, that it could improve their lives. It was the era when governments built big dams and big projects and pretty much ignored the rights of individuals. That was as true in America as it was in the Soviet Union, in a very different way, of course, but the results were the same in terms of individual freedom. But he said it was interesting because at this time, when intellectuals were saying there could be no respectable philosophy of conservatism in America, when they didn't believe in the free market, he said things were going on that they didn't notice and that he didn't notice before he started to write the book. First, he said, the most important publishing decision of the late 20th century had been made in 1947 by the Reader's Digest, which had decided to publish in this country a little book called The Road to Serfdom by Friedrich Hayek, which, as he said, with a couple of other books, changed the world. And as evidence of the influence of The Road to Serfdom, which I assume most of you have read or are at least familiar with, was two examples that he gave. First, there was a fellow in California, a liberal actor, who read it and acknowledged later that it changed his way of looking at the world. That was Ronald Reagan. And there was an undergraduate in Britain who carried it in her purse and referred to it often. And she grew up to be Margaret Thatcher. Two people who had as much influence on the later 20th century as anybody in the world. And their thinking was shaped by a book, by ideas, by principles that were included in that book. And Yergin said then, nobody noticed at the time, but free market economists got together to form in the United States something called the Philadelphia Society, and internationally something called the Mount Pelerin Society. And soon on college campuses and among writers, there developed what became a coherent philosophy of free market conservatism, the belief in American tradition and the founding and the Constitution. And at some point, this began to become a political movement. And it's interesting because he observed that if you look throughout history, that political movements that really change things don't begin as political movements, they begin as intellectual movements, as philosophical movements, as people come to them committed to and developing an appreciation for the ideas that provide the foundations of what later becomes a political movement. And that's what happened as the modern American conservative movement developed. You know, I remember a fellow, a certified liberal, maybe he's more than that, who came to me years ago writing a book called Before the Storm about the Goldwater candidacy of 1964. And he couldn't understand it. And he asked me two questions which showed his lack of understanding of history. He said, first of all, I see all these references in the literature of the time to little old ladies in tennis shoes. What does that mean? It meant that citizens were starting to get involved in politics for the first time at that point in our history. And he said, and secondly, how did Young Americans for Freedom and a couple of other groups in 1962 get 18,000 people to show up in New York City at Madison Square Garden to hear people like Barry Goldwater, who most Americans at that point weren't very familiar with? The idea of 18,000 people gathering together to hear a political speaker today is difficult unless you're a dyed-in-the-wool socialist who likes to hear the rants of an angry old man from Vermont. But he couldn't understand how conservative ideas could motivate people to get involved in that way. It's the ideas that made all the difference. The Goldwater candidacy of 1964 came about because of young people like you, or me at that time. It came about because in 1960, Barry Goldwater's name had been put into nomination for the Vice Presidency of the United States at the Republican Convention in Chicago. And when he got up to withdraw it, remember, the movement was at that point more a movement of ideas than of political reality. He got up and gave what in the history of the movement is a famous speech in which he said, "Conservatives, grow up. We can take over this party. We can run this country." 4 years later, he was nominated as the first conservative candidate for president. He lost for a variety of reasons, mostly because we'd had disasters in this country and the people didn't want many more changes. He was demonized, he was attacked, his ideas were attacked as irresponsible. And when it was over, Time Magazine and News Magazine, we didn't have Fox News, we didn't have all these things, published covers that said that the conservatism was now dead, that it had been tried, it had been found wanting, the public didn't want it, it was over, and the Republican Party was probably dead as well. 4 years later, a Republican president was elected. After that president got into trouble in 1974, Newsweek and Time published cover stories about the death of the Republican Party and the conservatism it apparently represented. The Republican Party at that time considered changing its name because the idea of being even associated with such a party was anathema, they felt, to millions upon millions of Americans. It was over, and Democrats could look forward to a great liberal future. That was in 1974, and 6 years later, the first conservative movement politician ever to be sworn in as President of the United States was sworn in as President Ronald Reagan. When Reagan left the White House, and Bush left the White House, and the Clinton administration began, we were told again that conservatism was dead, that history would show that Reagan had been a terrible president. After all, he'd been derided, remember, as an amiable dunce, among other things, as president. We were told he had nothing to do with ending the Cold War, that was really Mr. Gorbachev and the Soviets who decided that peace was the thing. And I remember going to a conference at Princeton a few years later on the history, the present, and the future of American conservatism, where there was a panel. And on that panel sat Lou Cannon, who was a reporter from California and later for the Washington Post, who was acknowledged to be the journalistic profession's major expert on Ronald Reagan and his career. He had written a book called Act of a Lifetime, the Role of a Lifetime, excuse me, about the Reagan presidency right after Reagan left office. And at this conference in the panel, he said, "I believe that Ronald Reagan may well have been the greatest president of my lifetime." And Stan Evans, who I mentioned a few moments ago and who passed on this year, immediately was on his feet in the audience and he said, "Lou, I listened carefully to your speech, and I think I understood what you said. Unfortunately, I read your book. And my question is, how could the man who wrote that book give this speech?" And Lou Cannon looked at Stan and he said, "I can do it because I'm still alive. And I wake up every morning realizing that Ronald Reagan was a greater president and a greater leader than I thought he was the night before when I went to bed." Conservatism, by that point, had emerged not just as a philosophical movement, but as a political movement with real clout and continues as strongly today as it was then. You know, we have amongst us people who always see the glass as half full, half empty, I should say. But it isn't. When you go back to the Reagan election, to the world we lived in at that time, you find that America at that time was pessimistic. We'd lost our leadership role in the world. We were in an era where there were interest rates that were above 20%, where inflation was above 20%, We'd been humiliated by Iran, of all places. And Americans were wandering around wondering how they were ever going to get out of this. They had a president whose major contribution to what we then saw as an energy crisis was to don a sweater and turn down the thermostat in the White House. He followed a president, a Republican, who said that the way we could get rid of all this was clean off our plates at dinner. We were supposed to dial back the optimism that had made America what it is. And then along came Ronald Reagan, who in a very short time managed to restore faith in this country, to develop within the public a greater and newer appreciation for the very values that made this country what it is, and who restored America's place in the world. Shortly after assuming the presidency, the United States bombed Muammar Gaddafi's Libya, and later, upon making the decision or in reflecting on that, people went back and read Ronald Reagan's diaries, and he called his assistants together and he says, "I think it's time to let the world know we have new management around here." And with a very few acts, he established that we did have new management and that America's best days were not behind us but in front of us. Doesn't all that sound familiar? Doesn't it sound like where we are today with the worst president since Jimmy Carter in our office, a man who squandered our defenses, who seems listless in his inability to lead America abroad, whose favorite term was leading from behind? I'll tell you, I was in Russia to speak to a gun rights conference a couple of years ago, and when you're in Russia, your hosts never mention President Obama because they think you're guests in their country and it would be embarrassing to bring up his name. I suspect that's true in a lot of other countries around the world as well. But that can all change, and it can change very quickly. It can change with new leadership. It can change as we sell our ideas and package our ideas for a new generation, which is your mission. You know, you didn't become conservatives, I don't think, for a job. You didn't become conservatives because you want to run for office, though some of you will hopefully take jobs that promote the movement, and some of you will not only run but be elected to office. You became conservatives, and you're here today, I'm willing to bet, because of those ideas, because of your belief in freedom, because of your belief in the individual, because of your belief in the values that make up the foundation of this country, and because of your desire to do what you can to make sure that you live the rest of your life and that your children live their lives in a country as great as the one that you inherited. That's why we're all here. That's why we're all involved. Your mission, though, is to deal with people of your generation, your peers, not just at your colleges, but in elections. You know, I was very concerned after the last two presidential elections, particularly because of the so-called youth vote. Barack Obama, for reasons that escape me, was able to pile up huge margins among young people. And the political reality is that there are two ways to affect political change in the United States. One is to bring in new voters, immigrants and others. And the other is to win the loyalty of an upcoming generation. Statistically, we find that very few people, after voting two or three times, change their allegiance. You know, the old terms of yellow dog Democrats. We all know people. I come from a Democratic family. My mother served five terms as the president of the International Auxiliary of the United Auto Workers in the 40s and 50s. So anecdotally, we know people that change their voting habits. But statistically, that's relatively rare. So if you lose an upcoming generation of voters two or three times, they are going to impact the outcome of elections for the next 40 years. Fortunately, the one rule of politics, the cynical rule of politics that Barack Obama seems to have understood, is that the only people you can afford to screw are your friends. and consequently almost all of his policies have hurt young people. And that hasn't changed a lot of their votes yet, but it's beginning to. And I bet you see that when you talk to young people around the country and you talk to them about your values and what's happened to them under progressive leadership. Because more young people are unemployed than ever before. College graduates are living with their parents who didn't have sense enough to put bars on the windows of their room so that they couldn't move back in. People with postgraduate degrees are flipping hamburgers at McDonald's and lobbying for a higher minimum wage because the American economy is not producing the way past generations have thought that it could, and which you know that it can. So your mission is to make sure that our values, your values, those values articulated so well by Friedrich Hayek, by Milton Friedman, by Bill Buckley, by Russell Kirk and others, are transmitted to your peers. Because if you do that, you have done as much as anybody can ever ask of a generation in the fight to continue the free traditions of this country. That's not always an easy task because we do have a hostile media. You know, I know you'll get, I don't know if you have it at this thing, but you have media training. And I'll tell you what it was like in the old days, another story. The first time I ever appeared on television was in 1970 during the Cambodian bombing. And I was chairman of Young Americans for Freedom, and I was invited to Washington to be on the Today Show, which was live, I guess it still is. And in those days, the hosts were Joe Garagiola, a broken down baseball catcher, and a very nice guy, and Barbara Walters. And they were very nice to me, and then I sat up there, and the red light was on, which meant the camera wasn't on. And before the interview was to go out over nationwide television, the first time I was ever on television, Barbara Walters leaned over to me and said, "There's something you should know before we start this interview." And I said, "Yes." She said, "I truly despise people like you." And then the light went on. And I always said, "Now that was media training." We did not face a friendly press or a friendly media. We didn't have the institutions that we have today, but we persevered. And one of the ways we succeeded was that enough of us who came up through Young Americans for Freedom, who read those books, who went to ISI seminars, and in today's world, who come to events like this, is enough of us remembered why we were here. We were and are here because we believe in those values. You know, Henry Hyde, the great conservative congressman from Illinois, once told me that one of the disappointments of the latter part of his life is that when somebody came to him wanting to run for office, he always said, "What's the one thing you would lose your office for if you were elected? What's the one policy position that you would stand up for, even if it was going to cost you the next election?" And he said, "The sad part is that in today's world, fewer people can come up with an answer to that question than used to be the case." Well, I bet that's not true in this audience, because we all have something tied to our values that we do believe in. And so my advice to you, whether you take a job within the movement, whether you go into the private sector and get rich so that you can run for office later, or give money to the person sitting next to you who's going to run for office, is remember why you're here. Remember what motivated you. I'll tell you another story. I came to this town at the age of 24. I was the youngest professional in the Nixon White House. I worked for then Vice President Agnew. I threw everything I had from school in Wisconsin. I drove out here with a U-Haul trailer behind me, and I got an office in what was then the old executive office building. And I put up my pictures and all this, and I decorated it. And a few days later, the Vice President of the United States came into my office, and he looked around, and he said, "Dave, you've done a really nice job decorating this office." This was 1970. And he said, "Do you remember who had this office when Hubert Humphrey was vice president?" And I said, "No, sir, I have no idea." He said, "It's funny because neither does anyone else." And he said, "A couple of things are going to happen to you now that you're in Washington and have a job. The first one is you're going to conclude very quickly that this job that you have is really important, and that there's really only one thing that's more important than this job, and that is that you have it. And he said, I'm here to tell you that neither one of those things is true. And I've often thought that every conservative who comes to Washington should get that lecture, because it's not the job, it's not what you do, or the fact that you hold a job. If you're elected, it's not that you're elected. Remember when Republicans took over the Congress in 1994, railing on against Democratic abuses and spending and the House bank and all of the different things that motivated voters that year. And within a year and a half, we're told by their leadership that the most important thing was not fixing any of these things, but making sure that they were reelected. Those were people that Henry Hyde despaired of. And those were people who thought that their job and the fact that they held it was more important than anything else in the world. It's not. What you do in whatever job you have, what you do in whatever path you take is what's important. And the important thing is that you remember why you're here and what it is you need to accomplish. If you do that, you're going to have a successful life, a happy life, and more important, you are going to be among those who are going to shape the history of this country in decades to come. Thank you very much. So in the interest of taking questions, I've cut my two-hour speech down to 20 minutes. And rather than go on, I'd like to try and answer anything. You don't have to limit your questions to what I talked about. Sometimes I give a talk and find that nobody in the audience really cares about what it was I talked about. So you can ask me about anything that you'd like, that you have any hint that I might know something about. And I make only one promise, that is I'll answer your question, and if I don't know anything about it, I'll tell you that. So.
Hi, my name is Katrina Lautenschlager, and I go to Liberty University. I was wondering if you could tell us how we could get more active as students. What could we do as millennials to further the conservative movement on our campus and for our country?
Well, there are lots of opportunities on college campuses to debate ideas, even if the other side doesn't want you to do that. And you know, what's politics all about? What is changing things all about? It's about engaging others. Most of your fellow students aren't interested at all in political activity. Some of them probably think you're weird because you come here. I know they thought I was weird. They were right, but not for that reason. But if you're going to influence other people, what you have to do is ask what it is they're interested in. How does that relate to what you believe in, and how do you communicate that to them in a whole variety of forums? One of the problems that the Democrats and some Republicans have today is that, take Hillary Clinton. Well, take her, I'd prefer not to. But the fact of the matter is that one of her problems is, in the language of not your generation, but someplace back there, is that she's so yesterday. I mean, these attacks on Uber and things like that means she doesn't get it. She comes from an era of big government and where government has solutions, where people ought to just be told what to do. And as people begin to realize that, particularly young people, they have to ask themselves, what's that all about? Because that's not the world we're growing up in, and that's not the world that's coming on. It's a world in which technology, if not our ability to win friends and influence people, has created an atmosphere where the younger generation wants to make its own decisions. And the real difference between us and them, if you will, is that they don't want people to make their own decisions. They want to make decisions for them. That's why they're upset about all of this, the sharing economy and all of these kinds of things, because it takes hands out of the hand, takes power and decision-making out of the hands of the people who they think ought to make that decision, which is them, because they consider that they're smarter than the rest of us. But that's a message that has to sink in, and if you can do that, then we're going to be fine.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Paige Burns. I go to Martinsburg College. Question is, just as the videos by James O'Keefe shed light on the liberal disaster formerly known as ACORN, do you feel that the Center for Medical Progress videos on Planned Parenthood will have the same effect on potentially defunding abortion on demand? Or do you feel that abortion, since Roe v. Wade, has had too much of a prevalent
I think that the that these videos of, and the haggling over the selling of baby body parts have the potential of changing the entire debate. You know, it's interesting. I did an editorial right after that happened and said these folks at Planned Parenthood have got to be fans of the old comic joke where the man is caught in bed with a woman by his wife, and he said, "Are you going to believe your lying eyes, or are you going to believe me?" And that's really what Planned Parenthood has been saying since then. I mean, it's a Richard Pryor joke, for those of you who remember Richard Pryor. And that's what they're saying. You're going to believe your eyes just because this guy, I mean, this is a bad guy. He taped all this stuff, and you're going to believe him? Because the tactic, of course, is to attack the messenger, not deal with the message. It's not going to work because this stuff is graphic. And O'Keefe started this. And it upsets them because nobody should be looking over their shoulders. They should be looking over ours. But in today's world, with the demise of truly nonpartisan, non-ideological investigative journalism, it is up to people who are in a position to demonstrate the truth in ways that these two groups did to have impact. And I think this is going to have incredible impact because, frankly, it's pretty disgusting. Oh, you. I have to go back and forth.
My name is Adam Wentworth, and I'm from California. I attend Oakbrook College of Law. And you had made comments about how...
You know, there's a whole country between California and New York. Just thought I'd let you know.
So, you made comments about how us as conservatives, we need to get more involved in the media and fight the liberal bias. Now, a close friend of mine saw that same thing in Spanish media here in the U.S. and wanted to reach out to the Hispanic community and show them the conservative truths in their own language using talk radio. My question is, why isn't conservatives doing more of that, reaching out to the
reaching out to other groups?
Community?
Well,
yeah,
we should.
Through media.
Obviously, we should. You know, it's interesting because you get different ways of how do you communicate with different groups. One way is you find somebody that looks like them and say, well, you ought to be for us because one of my friends looks like you. The other way is to actually talk to people and communicate your ideas and discuss those ideas with them. It's interesting because in Congress, on the whole question of immigration, there's a certain faction that says that, well, you can't discuss immigration policy because to do so will just upset generation upon generation of Hispanics. And yet, you know, it was interesting because the member of Congress who gets the highest percentage of the Hispanic vote in his or her district is a fellow from New Mexico by the name of Steve Pierce. And Steve is very strongly, they would say, anti-immigration. So why does he get all these votes? Because he's there. Because he talks to his constituents. He talks about his ideas and he listens to his constituents. There was a newspaper article that said if you were a Hispanic family in that district and you were moving on Saturday morning, your congressman might show up to help you move the furniture. Because he's there and he's involved. We have not, as a movement, and Republicans as a party, haven't gotten out and talked to people. We've accepted, to some degree, the liberal way of looking at the world. Well, this group won't listen to us. Since when have conservatives viewed people as members of a group as opposed to individuals? The whole philosophy that we follow treats people not as members of a group, but as individuals. And that means we have to talk to them as individuals and people. And if we do that, we're going to find out that we do better than a lot of people think we will, because there are a lot more people out there who would agree with us if we talk to them than we suspect. I got to go here.
My name is Michael Lucchesi. I'm a sophomore at Hillsdale College.
So that's in the middle of the country.
We have 16 candidates running for the Republican nomination right now. And in the conservative movement itself, there are a lot of divisions. The traditionalists, and the reform conservatives, and the libertarians, and so on and so forth. What lessons from the early beginnings of the conservative movement have you learned that can help us sort of reunite the movement today?
Well, I used to say that conservatives are by their nature a fractious bunch. When there were three of us, there were at least four different divisions. And we argued about it. Frank Meyer, who some of you may recall, was the sort of the conscience of the early movement and was at National Review. He was one of my early mentors. And he developed something that he called fusionism, in which he took economic conservatives, traditional conservatives, free market conservatives, and strong anti-communists at the time, put them together and said, let's argue about these things after we take over the world. When we got the White House, we started to argue about them again. And years ago at CPAC, we had honored Jim Buckley, my old boss, who remains a very close friend, and the late Gene McCarthy, who were the two men who joined up to challenge the election laws of the 1970s. And Senator McCarthy got up and he said, thanked us for recognizing what he had done. And then he said, you know, I came in here and I want to tell you conservatives something, you're in trouble. He said, because as I walked up here, I heard people talking about neoconservatives and paleoconservatives and economic conservatives and these. And he said, you know, I was a liberal, and that happened to me. And when they start hyphenating your description, you're in trouble, because it means you're dividing. We all have different things that we emphasize, but one of the great strengths of the movement over years has been that there's more that we all agree on than there is that we disagree on. And in a political world, as opposed to a philosophical seminar, you emphasize the things upon which you agree more than the things about which you disagree. And if you do that, you can be successful. And I think we can do that even today. The other difference between then and now, you know, it was easy for us. We had Goldwater or whoever and Nelson Rockefeller. So we didn't have to have 16 people or all these divisions. We just had them and us. And everybody knew who us were, and everybody knew who they were. And so we could get right to it. In today's world, it is incredible that we've got this many candidates for the presidency, but none of them, some of them are less truthful than others, but none of them are standing around saying, I'm not a conservative and I never will be. That's what it was like in the 60s. Now they all say, you know, I'm really a conservative. So why don't you support me? That's because we have come to dominate the thinking and the ideas. So these folks who want to be president know that in order to get there, they have to be conservative in one sense or another. Now, there are different ones. There are people who are primarily interested in foreign policy and defense. There are those who are more wedded to economic policies and the like, and there are more those that are more what we used to call traditional American values policies. But most of them agree with each other. They just put a different emphasis on it. You know, when we did CPAC over the years, every year we would have a straw poll, but the important part of that was we'd ask some questions that would tell us something about the audience. And one of the questions over about 25 years was, do you consider more important economic policies, these different things? And the interesting thing was that while in the discussion, it would appear that things had changed. After all, when we were dealing with the Soviets, it looked like foreign policy was the main issue. When we got into the social issues, it looked like they were economic issues under other. It turned out that the divide never changed. And the thing that bound people together was freedom. And that's still the case. So whether you're an economic conservative, a traditionalist, a foreign defense conservative, it's freedom. That's what it's all about. I was, as you know, president of the National Rifle Association. And beginning with Charlton Heston, we used to say, it's not about guns. It's about freedom. And that's what everything we do, all of us, is about. And if we keep that in mind, we can put together not just these camps within the movement, but we can put together those camps with people who have never even considered themselves conservatives.
Hi. First, I wanted to thank you so much for speaking to us today. My name is Emma Cardwell, and I'll be a junior at Davidson College in North Carolina in the fall. I write for my school newspaper, and I sometimes worry about being too strong on my conservative ideas. And I was wondering if you could maybe talk a little bit about like how your political beliefs and like founding YAF at Wisconsin, how that affected your growth as a budding journalist when you were in school?
I'm an accidental journalist. I'm an accidental everything. you know, people come to me. It's amazing. I mean, I'm not making fun of your generation, but people come to me and some of them got this whole plan about how their life is going to work, you know, and they're going to do this and that and that, and then they're going to end up there. And I said, well, you're talking to the wrong guy because I didn't have a plan. I just did at various times what I thought was the right thing to do, and I ended up where I am. And you're going to get opportunities, you're going to get setbacks, but you stick to your values and you do what you need to do. I was the editor of my high school newspaper. You know, one of the ways the world has changed is that now everybody goes to college and it's all financed by somebody, I don't know who. We didn't have student loans back in those days, and if you weren't sort of the son or grandson of an elite, you didn't go to Harvard and Yale. I did want to go to journalism school, and I applied to Northwestern in Evanston, Illinois, knowing that there was no way I could ever pay the tuition. So I only applied to see if I could be accepted. So I went to Wisconsin because I was a Wisconsin resident, and it cost me $100 a semester, and I could afford that. Then I went to law school because I couldn't think of anything else to do. And after law school, I was lucky to get a job in Washington and worked in the White House and worked on the Hill. And finally, somebody asked me to write a column, and I'd always liked to write. So I wrote for the Hill newspaper for 13 years as a part-time columnist. And then after I finished my gig at the NRA, just yet another volunteer gig, the folks at the Washington Times came to me and said, you can't retire, which is what I really wanted to do, because I wanted to go fishing and I wanted to use my guns. They said, you know, we're supposed to be the conservative newspaper and nobody knows what that is anymore. So I said, well, I'll come over there and tell them what I think it is. And that's how I got to where I am today. But it was all accidental. And the one piece of advice I give people, it's not about the planning, it's not about just doing whatever comes into your head, but there are a million ways to affect the world and more than a million ways to make a living. And I know people that I went to school with who've made a lot more money than I have and aren't very happy. And so the one piece of advice, of professional advice that I give people is think about what you really want to do and go and do it, and then you can be happy. So that's my advice.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, my name's Trevor Chacall, and I'm going to be a freshman here at George Washington this year. My question is about our generation specifically. We've been called by many...
I'm not part of it, so I'm...
No, I know. But I'll get to it. So we've been known as the me generation. And along with that comes a skepticism about our generation. And I was wondering, in your opinion, why hasn't the conservative ethic of individualism and individual achievement matched and resonated more with millennials? And what can we do to help those two things match together?
Well, remember my generation, we were the Woodstock generation, for God's sakes. You know, so, but most of us survived and we overcame all of that. And we did accomplish some things, particularly those of us who set out to follow a life guided by principle. And the same is true of your generation. You have a problem, though, or the country has a problem, or our society has a problem. And that stems from the fact that the media is, in fact, worse than it ever was, that the campuses today are worse than they were when I was a student. Because today, you wouldn't get somebody to sign on as your campus advisor, even though he disagreed with you. He'd probably suspect that you ought to be called before a disciplinary board for thinking bad thoughts. But it really amounts to communicating your values to others through whatever forum. And that means those who go into journalism are important. You know, you only learn what you're taught. I use this as a whole different speech, so this will be my very truncated version of this. But just my primary example of that is Woodrow Wilson. What do you know about Woodrow Wilson? Great president, school at Princeton's named after him, all of this sort of thing. What do you know about Warren Harding? He was sort of an earlier version of Bill Clinton and didn't do anything, wasn't much of a president. The reality is that Woodrow Wilson was the first president to attack the American Constitution publicly. He was a man who said he'd keep us out of war and then went to war. Until Woodrow Wilson came along, we didn't have separate but equal facilities in the government. Woodrow Wilson was offended by the fact that black Americans could use the same facilities he did, so by executive order, he segregated the government. This is the man we consider a hero. Warren Harding became president, and the other thing that Woodrow Wilson did during World War I was he locked up hundreds of people who disagreed with him. If you study history, you study about the Palmer raids and his attorney general was condemned by the left for fighting communism and anarchism. But in fact, what they did was they locked up newspaper editors, they locked up reporters, they locked up people who criticized the government. And as Woodrow Wilson was about to leave office, his attorney general came to him. And one of the people locked up for 10 years was Eugene Debs, who'd run for president as a socialist. And he said, "Mr. President, history is not going to look well on what we've done. And I think we need to sign these pardons." Woodrow Wilson, in his final act as president, picked up the pile of pardons and threw them across the room and said, "Never." That's the man we consider a hero. Warren Harding's first act as president was to pardon all of them and invite them to a dinner at the White House, saying this is not a country where we lock people up for their beliefs and what they say, only if they do something that's illegal. Warren Harding and I went to Birmingham, Alabama, as president of the United States, and he spoke to an audience of 15,000, and from the podium down to the end was a chain link fence. One half of the audience was black, the other half was white, and Harding said that the American dream will never be realized until such time as every American is treated equally. He's not remembered for that. And I started to compare the two because the state of Ohio was going to close down Harding's home because there wasn't much interest in it. And why isn't there any interest? Because the media, the academics, loved Woodrow Wilson because he believed in a central government with power. In addition to those things that Warren Harding did, he inherited a recession. And he didn't jump into it with the government. He backed off, lowered the debt, and the recession ended very quickly. And he's forgotten today, not because of what he did, but because what people didn't report on what he did. So that's a problem. And it's a problem that continues on a variety of fronts. You saw it, earlier somebody was talking about the media reaction to the videos on Planned Parenthood. The major media didn't report them. Why would they? They're on the other side. Our job, oftentimes, is to overcome that. And fortunately, we live in a world where you can overcome it. Because we live in a world where people get their news in other ways, ways they couldn't get it when I was your age. So it's tough, but we can do it. And besides, we now have remotes for our television. Oh, I'm sorry. I keep going to the right. I don't know why that is.
My name is Chris Condon. I'm attending Gettysburg College in the fall. And before you were talking about how you worked with Vice President Agnew, and I was just wondering what it was like for you when he ultimately resigned from office and got brought up on tax evasion charges. I thought that would be kind of interesting.
Well, it was not a good day. And I remember I'll tell you, during the era of Watergate and all of that that went on, there were a lot of tough days. In fact, in 2006 when Republicans lost so much, I was over at the White House, and one of the young aides, they were all young by that time, came up to me and said, "You were in Washington in 1974, weren't you?" And I said, "Yes, I was." And he said, "Was it this bad?" I said, "It was a lot worse than this." I said, "All you have to do is realize that you got to get up in the morning and do your job, and things will go on. The sun's still going to rise tomorrow morning. It's still going to set. The values are the same." Vice President Agnew brought me to Washington. He was unique among politicians in my experience because he was forming his, he was not a philosophical man. He was, had been a county executive. And he was, he told me, and this goes to the media, he was as, if you study the period, and I know most of you weren't born, he was elected governor of Maryland against a Democrat whose slogan was, "Your home is your castle." And it was a racially tinged campaign, as one can imagine from that. And upon his election, he was dubbed by the Washington Post and the Eastern media as a great hope for the Republican Party because he was moderate and he was smart and there were all these things. And then he told me, he said, "You know, people," he said, I never read what's in the newspaper because," he said, "you know, when we went to that convention, the day before I was one of the brightest, most compassionate people the Washington Post had ever met. And then I was nominated by Richard Nixon, and the next day I was the dumbest Neanderthal that had ever walked the earth." And he said, "Now, they may have been wrong the first time, but I didn't change that much overnight. This was a partisan press." He was, to those, 25 years later, a young reporter for the Baltimore Sun was asked to do a piece on Agnew 25 years later. And this guy must have been 24. So he wasn't even alive. And he called me toward the end. He said he had reached out to many people who'd worked for Agnew, and it was remarkable because in their conversations, they really said two things. And I said, "I know what they were. And I haven't talked to any of them." He said, "What were they?" I said, "One was there was integrity. There was intellectual integrity. He came out of a state where, as you know, the values in a southern state in those days are different than the values in Washington." I said, "So," he said, "yeah, I couldn't figure out why they associated integrity with a man who had to leave office." And I said, "Because he had great integrity." And the second thing they all said, I told you, is that, and a lot of them went on to work for presidents. I did a lot of different things. I said, "They all told you it was the best job they ever had." And he said, "That's exactly right." Because it was a night, it was where I met Gene Kirkpatrick and all of these people, because this was a man who was developing his philosophy as we might in college. And he'd read a piece in National Review or in Commentary or in the Public Interest or whatever, and he'd buzz me on the phone and say, "Dave, this Gene Kirkpatrick wrote a nice, why don't you get her in here? Let's have lunch with her and talk to her." That's what I spent my time doing. And that's something that never happened any other time in my career, so I owed him a lot. And let me just, another thing, I'm going on too long, but he's, after, when he went to court in Baltimore to plead nolo rather than fight this because his political career was already over. At 3 o'clock one afternoon. And the next morning at 7:30, I was at my desk in the executive office building the way I always was, and my phone rang, the intercom actually, and it was the vice president who had just destroyed himself not that long before. And he said, "Dave, my Secret Service agent told me on the drive in this morning that you're thinking about going back to Wisconsin." And I said, "Well, I thought it'd be a good time to leave." And he said, "You're not doing that. You do that and you'll be stained by this for the rest of your career. You're staying here in Washington. If I have to get on the phone and call everybody in town, you tell me what you want, I'll get it for you." That was the kind of guy that you could admire, because loyalty was everything to him. So
thank you.
All right, quick question. First of all, I'm Kara Bell, and I also attend University of Wisconsin-Madison, so hello, Badger. And what inspired you to even start the YAF chapter?
Well, you're there.
I'm a freshman, so I haven't actually been there yet.
What inspired, you know, and I got, actually, I started the YAF chapter there after the 1964 election. There had been at Wisconsin a group called the Wisconsin Conservative Club. which had been in existence for some time. We had a basement in a house, I forget what street it was on over there, and we had a library, we had all these books and we'd read them. And we also published, of which I was editor, a magazine called Insight and Outlook, which was the oldest continuously published for a decade student conservative journal in America. So we were there, but we didn't have a political arm. In 1964, I quit college the way McGovernites did in the 70s. I quit college for a semester to work in the Goldwater operation and see if we couldn't really elect somebody. After it was over, Al Regnery, who, if you remember from Regnery Publishing and the like, was a student at Beloit College, and he'd been appointed to be the state YAF chairman, but he didn't know anybody, and he heard about me, so he came up and said, well, why don't you form a chapter here, so we've got a chapter someplace. So I said, it's a deal. That's how I did it. And a historic note, up to that point in 1964, a group called the Collegians for Goldwater at the University of Wisconsin was the largest student group in the history of the University of Wisconsin, which did not mean that a majority of students were for Barry. It just meant that everyone that was in that group. So that's why. It's a great place, except in February.
Yep. Thank you.
That it? Thank you. Thank you very much for letting me be with you.
All right. Thank you again. We're going to take a couple-minute break. There's cookies and drinks in the back. And then be back here, 2 minutes. Thank you.